sit, stand, whatever whatever God says you to do. You're having a good time.
But we're excited about worship today. It's been we've been praying over the scripture passage, and we're excited about the songs that God led Jordan to pick today. And we're just going to invite and encourage everyone to just take a deep breath, because summer is here. God is good, that in spite of sometimes chaos, in spite of all the bad things we see in the headlines, that God is still good, and that no matter what is going on in our lives, when we come here, this is holy ground, and we're with family. That's all that matters. And so, just as we begin worship, let's pray. Lord, we are just so thankful for your goodness, for your presence, for the fact that, you know, you brought us here. Lord, this morning we lift up all of those in our church family and in our families and friend groups who are traveling this holiday weekend. Lord, we just pray for safe travels. We pray for those who are expecting this storm surge to hit where they are. Lord, may this weekend just be one of rest and renewal. May it be one, Lord, where people see your glory in church, in the everyday. May you just reveal yourself to each and every person, so that even those who do not know who you are see something, and they just know in their heart that there's something more. So Lord, we just pray your blessings upon this time and upon everyone here and upon all people. We trust in you, and we know that you're going to be faithful to us this day. It's in your Son's name we pray together.
Okay, that's good.
y'all follow Intersection or Erin on Facebook, you've seen the scripture, you know, prepare for it. What you think about when you think of 1 Corinthians 13 is the love chapter. And I was strongly pulled to choose, and you'll see a theme going through all these songs is love. Your love is alive. Just want everybody to think about that as we're worshiping here today. There's nothing more important than the love of Jesus Christ and the love of God, which on us. So we're going to continue to worship here, thinking about that.
I have heard a sound.
Another week where we can come and reflect, and think and pray and learn. We know that it's all because of you. It's because of the love that you have for us. And we just thank you for that. We thank you for being here today. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Jennifer Meek, the children's minister here at St. Matthew's, and it is time for our children's crosswalk. So if the children would come join me up front. No more friends? That's okay too. These are sweet friends right here. I'll take these friends. Here comes Patty. Well, hello. Oh, it looks like I can tell that's a cousin. Well, guess where Miss Jennifer is going Thursday? Going somewhere special. Can you guess, Finn? I'm going to sleep in a cave. Think I'm telling the truth? I am. I am sleeping in a cave. Raise your hand out there if you've never slept in a cave with Miss Jennifer. Here we go. But some people have done it a couple of times. Sometimes I recruit you to go back when you're older. But I'm taking our children who just finished the sixth grade, who are fixing to go into the youth group in August. We go sleep in a cave. And we go down and we play games. We go into the cave. It's this huge cave. It's bigger than this whole room. And then we do worship in the cave, which is really, really cool. And then we go to sleep. Some of us go to sleep. My rule is you don't have to go to sleep, but you have to be quiet. You can't keep other people up. And you have to get up at the crack of dawn when everybody else gets up. Those are my only rules. So, but during the night when I go to sleep, usually I have somebody, it's usually the toughest boys that I take, will wake up and go, Miss Jennifer, I need to walk up out of the cave to go to the bathroom. Will you walk with me? And so I usually don't get very much sleep. So the next morning we get up and we eat breakfast, we do another devotion, and then it could be my reward, is we go to Cheesecake Factory in Birmingham. But I love the trip. This will probably be my 10th time to take a group. And I love it, but about Tuscaloosa, I'm ready to get home. And I smell like a cave. I'm tired. I'm just ready to get home. And when I get home, the first thing I do is I take a shower because I got to wash off the cave smell, right? Who wants to smell like a cave? Then I have to do laundry because all my stuff smells like a cave. And then I get to put on my pajama bottoms and a t-shirt, and I get to go in my post-cave coma. And I sleep for 24 hours, and my family doesn't bother me. And that reminds me of a story about having to do, as much as I would love to just get home as quick as I want to from the cave and hop in the bed, there's things I have to do right, because I don't want to go to sleep smell like a cave, and I don't want to wake up to dirty laundry. So there's work to be done. And in our reading, in Rooted in Christ this week, we read last week we read about how God moved the people from their homeland, their promised land, because they didn't obey. And the only thing they wanted to do was to go home. But when they were able to go home this week, we learned there was work to be done. And they had to do work before they could relax. And we're the same way. As much as we would like to just stay in Jesus' arms and just be happy, there's still work to be done. What are some things we can do? Can we love people? We can help people. What are some things we can do? Not fight with our brothers and sisters. Those are all good things. So don't forget that as much as we love to just sit and be loved by God, we have to give that love back. There's love to be given. There's work to be done. Does anybody want to pray for us? No? You want me to pray? I will. Dear Lord, thank you so much for your love and grace. Help us to remember that there is work to be done, that we are not to just sit still and enjoy being at home in your heart, in your love, and in our church, but that we must be at work, and we must share it with others. In your most precious and wonderful name, amen.
As the children return to their seats, we just want to take this opportunity
to lift up a few things for all of us to be aware of, especially as summer is approaching. And so if you haven't gotten a newsletter, I'm going to really encourage you to get one today, because we have three inserts in the newsletter today. And these three inserts are very helpful. The first, this little postcard. This is for anyone with youth, or yes, Megan, anyone who would like to volunteer with you to do these things. This is what the youth are going to be doing this summer, and so if you have a youth, pay attention to it. Or yes, if you want to participate, contact Nicolette and Elizabeth and let them know that you'd like to volunteer and to participate and have fun with our youth this summer. And then there's also our church prayer list. How we can this week be prayerful and keep our church family in our hearts and prayers and be aware of what is going on in the lives of our faith community. And then there's this wrap card. If you were here last week, it was announced that our lead pastor, Amy Stoddard, is taking a renewal leave this summer in June and July. And if you know Andy, you know that he goes 110 miles an hour 24/7. And so this time of rest and renewal for him is just going to be a beautiful gift that our church is giving him and his family to rest and to come back in August just ready. And so our theme for the summer, Revive Us Again, is on the front with the image that Elizabeth came up with us. Now on the back is our preaching schedule. Since Andy's out, we're really bringing in guest preachers throughout the summer to primarily cover the traditional services, but a few, including I'm excited about my dad, will be an intersection. And so we're going to be having a few in here. And just guest preachers to share their hearts with our church this summer. And next Sunday is going to be a combined service here in Intersection at 11 a.m. This will be the only service, and so all of Hart Hall is going to be packed out. And if you are able or willing to get here at 9 to help set up, or if you're willing to help clean up or greet, please let me know, because any and all help would be much appreciated as we prepare to host everyone here next Sunday, as Reverend Kelly Pope, who's just a sweet, sweet man, will be guest preaching as we celebrate in communion with one another next week. And then also, for all of us to be aware of and to be remembering, is that we're coming up on Vacation Bible School. And so if you have not taken the time yet to sign up your children or to sign up yourself to volunteer, I'm going to encourage you to do so, because there is a registration deadline, and that date is in the newsletter. And then also in the narthex is a Christmas tree with ornaments with supplies on them for Vacation Bible School, because we host a little over 200 children every year for VBS, and so these supplies are going to help make sure that those kids have everything that they need to enjoy an amazing week that we are so excited to be putting on for them here at our church. Also, today is the last Sunday to purchase a chicken lunch plate ticket. Darby Grace and John and maybe some others have those tickets. And they're going to be selling them at the back table. They're $8 in advance, $10 Saturday. But our Chef Eddie does the special ingredients for the chicken. So you know the food's going to taste great. And all of this will go to help support our adult team who's flying out to Honduras in June. And so I'm going to encourage you to buy those tickets, because sometimes that chicken can last you two meals, and the pickup will be this coming Saturday morning. And then also, just look through the newsletter, look at what's coming up, and just be attentive to that, especially in the summer to come. But now we're going to continue in worship.
Will you please pray with me? Holy God, we just come here today so humbled by your presence, by this opportunity, Lord, to know you better. We just ask, oh Lord, for you to remove any barriers that stand in our way of hearing what you have to say to us, because, Lord, it's only your words that we won't heard. Nothing from me. Lord, may you just open our hearts, open our ears, and just give us your peace and your wisdom and your guiding, Lord. It's in your holy and precious Son's name that we trust. Amen. Today, in our Bibles, we're going to be looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and the very last sentence of 1 Corinthians 12. But before I get to 1 Corinthians 13, I want us to talk some about 1 Corinthians 12, because 1 Corinthians 13 obviously builds on what chapter 12 has to say. And in chapter 12, we find Paul writing about spiritual gifts. And about how when we come to know Jesus as Lord, when we come to know his truth, the Holy Spirit comes and makes a home within us. That the Holy Spirit places within each and every one of us particular gifts. That each and every one of us, no matter our age, has gifts. That we have something to contribute. Because in Scripture it says, and I can't think of where it is at the moment, in Scripture it says that in each particular community of believers, that the Holy Spirit ensures that all the gifts are present within the body of believers to ensure that God's mission is fulfilled through that body of believers. That each and every one of us is necessary. That each and every one of us has gifts to bring to the table. That no gift is lesser or greater than another gift. And that is sometimes really important. Andy sometimes says that, you know, the preachers and the musicians, those at the front, sometimes get too much attention. But it is every piece of the puzzle, is everyone's gift that makes this church what it is. Is everyone being present and taking ownership that makes the body of Christ work. It takes all of us. It takes all of us being willing not to belittle our gifts, but to own them. It takes all of us choosing not to concentrate on perfecting our gifts necessarily, but on just being faithful with our gifts. On being faithful to use them, and trusting that even if we don't think it's perfect, that when we are faithful, that's all it takes. It's just us being faithful with the gifts that the Holy Spirit has placed within each of us. That's getting out of our heads about our gifts and being willing to step out of our shells and to put our gifts front and center, being willing to offer them up to the whole. But it's also important in spiritual gifts that we remember, because spiritual gifts, it becomes so about the individual when we talk about spiritual gifts. It's about what gifts each of us brings to the table. But spiritual gifts should always be talked about in terms of the whole. In terms of how and why we use these gifts. Their purpose. The reason that we're doing we're doing what we're doing. And that's what brings us to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. As I said, we're going to start actually from the very last sentence of chapter 12, where Paul says, "And I will show you a still more excellent way." He's going to show us a way to use our gifts as a community of believers, as individuals who come to this table, to this community. "And I will show you a still more excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide. These three, and the greatest of these is love." This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
As Jordan said, this is considered the love chapter. And typically when we think about this chapter, we think about it in the context of weddings, because it's a beautiful passage to hear in that context of a couple devoting their lives to one another, committing to one another. The values of love, that love is patient and kind and does not insist on its own way. It's beautiful to hear those reminders, but this passage wasn't written just with two people in mind. This passage was written for the whole of the faith community. Because in marriage, those two people choose one another. They choose to commit to one another. In the body of Christ, we don't really choose one another. We choose Jesus, and we come here and we find ourselves all choosing Jesus. And we look around and we see other people. Other people who we may not necessarily associate with outside of church. But here and now we come together and we have this one thing in common. But it's, as a community, we hear in this chapter about the importance of love in this community. And we've said it before, and today will be the last time we've said this. Loving is hard. Being in community is hard. Because all of us here have known what it is like to be hurt by others. All of us even know what it's like to be hurt by fellow believers. Some of us know what it's like to be hurt by the church.
aches and their heart. Yet here Paul devotes an entire chapter talking about its importance. Because the thing is, as not just any community, but as a faith community, as a people who are called the body of Christ, we have to remember that our foundation is love. And that in the context of faith community, that we have to be willing in the body of Christ to forgive one another. We have to be willing in the body of Christ to muster up the humility within ourselves to ask for forgiveness when we have wronged someone else. Because in the body of Christ, we are a people who come together and are bound with one another by the name of Jesus Christ. We are a people who together have known and experienced the love of Christ. We have experienced what it means to have been washed clean by the blood of Christ. We are the people who know the truth of a risen Lord in this world. In spite of the brokenness that we see around us, we see and know this truth. We have that in common. And as the body of Christ, that we come together seeking to choose God's will over our own will, over our own self-interest at times. And that's hard. But we know God's will for us, we've glimpsed it in Jesus Christ. God's will for us is to know love and to show love. And love is powerful. Look back at the opening verses of chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to move mountains or remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. So Jesus said, if you have faith the power of the size of a mustard seed, you can tell a mountain to move and it will move. And yet this is saying that doesn't matter if you can move a mountain or remove it. If you don't have love, it's nothing. If I give away all my possessions, if I hand over my body, this is saying if you are willing to die for Jesus' name, but do not have love, you gain nothing. Because what's important here, what Paul is trying to remind us here, is that it's not about what we do. Is about the force that drives us. Because we can do everything that we think is right. But it's when we choose to be faithful, when we choose to act out of love, love and faithfulness go hand in hand. All that matters is when love is our driving force, when love is the foundation and the root of everything that we do. Love is what we are to concentrate on as the body of Christ. But again, it's messy and hard. Because we are all broken people and we come to this place and at times we are going to see brokenness slip in. We're going to fail.
experiences and you just want to hide in the corner. Sometimes we're going to want to walk away because brokenness tries to slip in. But the thing is that we are able to love only because we have known love. It is only because we have known and experienced the love of God that we are able to love one another, that we are able, as broken people, to come together and to be called the body of Christ, to be called a holy community, to be called heirs to the kingdom of God, sons and daughters. It is the love of God that changes everything for us as individuals and us as a whole. Because it's as John 3:16-17 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes in him will not perish, but will have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world in order for the world to be condemned by him, but so that the world would be saved through him." We have known love because we have known the truth of a God who enters time to call us home and to hang on a cross till death for us to know our worth in God's eyes. We know the abundant love of God for each of us individually and for all of us as a whole. We have known the love. We experience it. And it is the love of God that makes a way for us as believers to come together with all of our flaws, with all of our gifts, with everything that we have, all of our differences, and be the body of Christ. It is the love of God that is the foundation and the centerpiece of who we are. Love of God that calls us here. It is the love of God that when we choose to trust him, even with fellow broken people, that when we trust him and choose to be faithful to his call to love one another, that we may then love one another. That we may come together and choose to walk with one another through the messes, through the miracles, through the valleys, and through the everyday. It's the love of God, not our own effort. It's the love of God that calls us and guides us. All we have to do is trust. Trust that God is who he says he is. Trust that he is the God we have come to know. To just allow his love to refocus us and to drive us. So as a people who all know the truth of Jesus as Lord, as a people called together by God, given gifts by the Holy Spirit for the upbuilding of the community, for the purpose of together witnessing to the world what it means to be the body of Christ, what it means to serve a risen Lord. How are we loving one another? How are we loving Is it because we feel like we're supposed to? Or is it because we are choosing to be faithful and choosing to act out of the love we have for our God who calls us here? May we hold those questions in these closing moments of worship as the offering baskets are passed and as the worship team comes to lead us in a final song. The front will be open for any who feel led to come forward and pray. But may we take this time and begin to think about how we are living out the love as believers that God has called us to show. Let us pray. Lord, in spite of every flaw that we see in ourselves and every flaw that we can sometimes see in the church, because we are broken people called together, may we choose to see your love that fills every crack, every hole. It is your love, Lord, that creates us, the church. Your love that builds us up, your love that sustains us, your love that drives us, your love that has given us new life. Every time that we just want to give up, Lord, may you just direct our eyes and our hearts to you so that we may trust you and trust you enough to be who you've called us to be. Your body in this world, for all to come and see and hope in your abundant love. We trust you, Lord. It's in your Son's name. Amen. up to us. But when we look to God, He will be faithful to us. When we look to Him, like Nora's looking at her dad. And then we go to Him. He's going to make a way. So may we choose to go forth looking to our Father and His abundant love. Choosing to love our one another. Go forth in peace until we meet again. Amen.
She loves him so much. She's like, 3 seconds. She's going to touch him. And then she's like, done.